So with that as why we're gathered, as it were, here today, let's think a little bit about myeloma and what it is. You might hear the word myeloma, and some people think it's like a skin cancer or something, where in fact that's melanoma, so it's a very different thing. But myeloma, or sometimes called multiple myeloma, is a blood cancer that we're going to describe a little bit as we go. So what is your blood? So your blood is what circulates in your body, and it's made up of two things. You've got the liquid stuff in there, and then you got some solid stuff that's circulating inside of it. Sometimes I say we can think of wine, red, white, and rosé, but there are three kinds of cells or solid stuff that circulates in your blood. There are red cells, there are white cells, and there are not really called rosé cells, but things we call platelets. So if the red cells, these are just little red trucks, basically, that carry oxygen. So you breathe in, oxygen comes into your lungs, the red cells pick up that oxygen, and then they go deliver them to all the parts of your body that need oxygen, because everything in the body needs oxygen. White cells, think of them like the army. They're like soldiers in the army. They're big ones or small ones. Some fight on the front lines, some stay at headquarters. In fact, there are five kinds of white cells, kind of like we have five, if you will, major branches of the military. And these are the cells that help defend you. And then lastly, we have these little cells called platelets. Platelets are cells that are meant to help you clot. If I cut myself, the first thing to get there, kind of like an ambulance, it gets there first and it plugs up the hole. So this is what's circulating in your blood, and that's what you use every day. But what you may not know is that your cells and your blood, those red, white, and platelet cells, and the blood that's circulating in your body is made in the factory of your blood, which is called the bone marrow. And that factory is inside most of your big bones, like in your hips and in your spine. And it's constantly making blood and pushing it out into the circulation so that you have fresh blood all the time. That's the basics of blood. And we're going to see, of course, how unfortunately myeloma, multiple myeloma, is a cancer of the blood, or specifically of a part of the factory of your blood, a part of the bone marrow. So what's cancer in general? Well, we think cancer is just uncontrolled growth. Whether it's a lump of breast tissue or lung tissue or colon tissue, you can think of it just growing. Well, this is kind of what happens. And the body has this usual balance where it allows cells to grow for a period of time, and then the cells are passed on and we make new ones. Well, what happens sometimes in cancer is that those cells refuse to die and they just keep growing and growing and growing and multiplying, and that's what makes tumors. What's weird with blood cancers is that they're not just a tumor of a piece of lung or skin or breast. These are actually the cells that are working for you, like those army cells, like those white cells. They become cancerous. And so now the very cells that are meant to defend you, and you know, we've been talking, for example, during this pandemic, how we make antibodies. Well, believe it or not, the very cells that make your antibodies, what are called plasma cells, are the ones, unfortunately, that now become cancerous with multiple myeloma. So instead of making good antibodies to fight off COVID or the flu or measles, mumps, rubella, now they're actually hurting you. So myeloma is a cancer of the plasma cell. So in the picture here, you might see these little cells on the side with these funny little shaped triangular things or these Y-shaped things called antibodies. Those are the antibodies that we make every day to fight off, as I said, measles, mumps, rubella, whatever else. Now in myeloma, those cells become bad. They're no longer normal plasma cells. Now they're cancerous plasma cells, and they make bad antibodies. And those antibodies we sometimes call M proteins or monoclonal proteins, because they're not polyclonal or many like they're supposed to be, measles, mumps, rubella. They're all the same type. That's what cancer is. Remember, it's identical growth. That same piece of lung tissue just keeps growing and growing and growing. So now this group of plasma cells are making this bad protein that unfortunately can attack the kidneys and can attack the bone. As I mentioned here, it's about 2% of all cancers. But as we indicated earlier, it's twice as common in the African-American population. And although we're seeing huge improvements, we are still going to see about 35,000 patients diagnosed this year and tragically nearly 13,000 deaths. But we want to make a change in this. We want to see the improvement, not just seen in all myeloma patients, but especially in the African-American population, because as you can see here, although survival has improved so much in the African, in the white population, we've not seen the same within the African-American population. So to summarize, myeloma is a cancer of the plasma cells. It makes these bad antibodies. And you know, in medicine, we love to use words that patients don't understand. So instead of using the word antibodies, we use the word immunoglobulin. And immunoglobulin is just a fancy word for antibody or even for protein. And we have different types of those antibodies, what are called G, A, M, D, and E. And this is a disease that's more often than not diagnosed in the 60s and early 70s. Although we mentioned earlier that the average age of diagnosis is younger in both the African-American population and in the Hispanic population. So how do people present with myeloma? People don't just walk into the office and say, oh, doc, I got some plasma cells that aren't looking so good. No one looks into their own bone marrow. No one can see what's going on there. These are the three most common things. And you can see why it's challenging to make the diagnosis, because who of us this week haven't been fatigued or have bone pain or back pain? And I don't mean to make light of it, but these are things that are very common. What we get very fatigued is the blood counts drop, what's called anemia here. And so doctors should know when the red, remember we talked about the red, white, and the platelets, when the red count is low, we have to wonder, why does someone have a low red count? And that's almost universal with myeloma. Almost every patient with myeloma has a low red blood cell count. And they get to have bone pain, typically in the back, but it could be in the shoulder, it could be in the ribs, it even could be in the hip or the legs. So myeloma, as I mentioned earlier, and I don't want to get into too much detail, is preceded or has this sort of precondition where, you know what, sometimes some of our plasma cells can go a bit funny and make a little bit of a bad protein, but not enough to ever hurt you, right? Just like you might have a tiny little skin tag or something that is not really skin cancer, but it just looks a little funny. And the doc says, oh, let me just keep an eye on that. I don't think we need to do anything about it. And it may never become anything. It'll just sit there like a mole, but sometimes it grows into something serious. Well, myeloma has the same thing, where in myeloma, people have this little bit of protein in their blood. It doesn't really hurt anybody, but we need to keep an eye on it because it could grow. And it grows into what we call active myeloma. So when we see more than 10% of that factory, so remember I said that the bone marrow is the factory of your blood. If over 10% of the factory is making these plasma cells, that's not normal, because normally it should be about 1% to 2%. And if we start seeing damage in the body, which I'll show you here, in what we sometimes call CRAB, which is to say that the calcium level in the blood goes up because bones are releasing calcium. Renal or kidney damage, these proteins go and attack the kidney. The anemia that we talked about before, a low blood cell count, and then bone disease. Sometimes it literally thins the bone and can cause fractures and a lot of pain. We've also added some other blood tests that we measure and x-rays that we measure for diagnosing myeloma, that if someone has over 60% of their plasma cells. So imagine you've got a bone marrow factory. We're only supposed to have 1% to 2% doing something. Now you have 60. The factory is not going to work well. If I have a car factory, and typically 1% to 2% of my car factory are making steering wheels, but now 60% of the factory are making steering wheels, I'm just not going to make as many cars. And that's kind of what happens in myeloma, is that the bone marrow gets filled up with making these bad proteins, and we can't make the good things that our bone marrow typically makes. So other ways to think about this is that the low blood counts, as we mentioned, can cause anemia that makes people tired. People can feel weak if their kidneys aren't working well. People can have bone pain. And sometimes just by virtue, you're devoting so much of your effort to this cancer, your body's effort to the cancer, you don't know what's happening. That's why people feel tired and they lose their appetite and they may even lose weight. Now, there is a small subset of patients that really don't have symptoms at all, which is one of the reasons why it's always important to stay in touch with your primary care doctor or healthcare team, do your usual screening and tests so that we can check on your health in general. So when we come to be treated, so let me talk a little bit about treatment now. I've talked a bit about diagnosis, talk a little bit about treatment, and then Dr. Badros will talk to us a bit about what it is to be treated later on in myeloma. There is lots of factors. And I like to put this slide up because it reminds me in the middle that your voice matters. And we're going to hear from Bonnie about this a little bit later, but that we don't just as the doctor come and say, you'll take it and you'll like it. That's how we treat myeloma. Your preference has to be involved. And now, as I'm going to show you in a moment, we have more options than ever. with multiple myeloma. And so we want to make sure you're involved in that process. Part of that may be getting a second, or I prefer the phrase, expert opinion. And that's not to speak ill in any way of your oncologist or someone's local oncologist, but myeloma is a pretty narrow field and it's pretty specialized. And so sometimes it may be helpful to see an expert in the field. I spend a lot of my time, and I know Dr. Badros spends a lot of his time doing this, where we see patients in an extra consultation to guide and help the doctor who's taking care of them and the team that's taking care of them to make sure the diagnosis is accurate, to give more information, to get a chance to speak to the expert and ask some of those questions that hopefully you'll come up with today, and indeed sometimes even provide clinical trials. Now, treatment for myeloma is like an alphabet soup. I mean, I've been treating myeloma for over 20 years. I cannot believe how many drugs we have. And there's no way that I'm going to describe all of these drugs to you. That's not the purpose of this workshop. I just can't go into this level of detail. But suffice to say, we have several classes of drugs, of which the three major classes, as we sometimes think of, are the two at the top here, what are called IMIDs, or immunomodulatory drugs, proteasome inhibitors, and the bottom line, what are called monoclonal antibodies. So these are drugs that we know, and another way of looking at it is these pillars in color here, that we have the proteasome inhibitors, the immunomodulatory drugs, the monoclonal antibodies. And we also have this thing called alkylators, which is more of this historical standard chemotherapies that we still use, especially for stem cell transplants. On the outside, I've put another four rings of other drugs that you're going to hear a little bit about from Dr. Badros when we think of newer things that we have for myeloma. So when we talk about initial or first therapies, or the very first time someone gets treated, I could bore you all day today with, say, well, we have this regimen, we have that regimen, we have the other regimen. I'd rather keep it simple today and say, here are the principles that we follow. And then I'm going to share with those who are a little bit more experienced in myeloma some of the more important, relevant new questions that we have in myeloma. So what about these principles? Principle number one. When we treat people up front, it has an impact in the long term. So in myeloma, we want to, if you will, use our best up front, right? I don't know if you're Baltimore Ravens fans. I don't want to get anybody in trouble with different sports teams. But, you know, when you go into that Super Bowl game, no disrespect, but you don't put the bench on first, right? You put the best players in there, whether it's Lamar or whoever else for Baltimore, you put the best team out there at that first quarter because you want to get a lead, because you know that lead is going to potentially stay for the rest of the game. Kind of like that in myeloma. We want to do our best up front. We're learning that we don't so-called save the best for last. That's principle number two. We want to use good therapies up front. We don't save the best, if you will, for last. Point number three, myeloma is very complicated. It really, to be honest, the name of it is good, multiple myeloma, because it's not even really one kind of cancer. It's kind of multiple ones kind of stuck together in many ways. And so we have to use different drugs together to get it. Kind of like if you've got weeds on your lawn. I know I live in Arizona, so I don't have much of a lawn. But back in the days in Canada, when I lived in Canada and I had a big lawn, if I was going to put a little bit of fertilizer to grow it, or if I was going to use a little bit of a weed killer to get rid of some of the weeds, a lot of those weed killers are mixes of different kinds of things to kill out the weeds. Similarly, in myeloma, one drug is not the answer. That's why I mentioned earlier how important those triplets were and why it's disturbing to me that African-Americans are less likely to get triplets. So we need to leverage, if you will, those combinations together. Principle number four, when we talk about treatment, we want two things. We want deep and durable remission. What do I mean by that? Whatever measure we have for the myeloma. So, you know, in a lung cancer, someone measures it with a ruler and says, unfortunately, ma'am, your lung cancer is 10 centimeters long. And we want to see it go down to 8 and to 4 and to 2 and to 1 and hopefully down to 0. And we want it to stay there. Well, similarly in myeloma, it's not as easy as a measure. We have different measures. Sometimes we measure that antibody level in the blood, sometimes called the M protein or the M spike. Sometimes we measure it through what's called the light chains, because these proteins can break off and look in different ways. you know, sorry for all the analogies, but I sometimes say that myeloma is kind of like a crime scene. There really isn't one piece of information that tells you the whole story. You have to look at the whole story. But nonetheless, as we do this, we want a deep and a durable response. We want to get those numbers down and keep them down. And so typically we mix and match from these three major classes of drugs, getting a triplet combination. We take two of those drugs plus a little bit of what we call steroid, and we mix them together. And then lastly, the final principle is that we decide whether or not someone should have a stem cell transplant, where we give a big whopping dose of chemotherapy, which in younger patients is actually very effective, but we want to use it correctly. So that's what we do at the start. When someone gets diagnosed, are you going to transplant or are you not going to transplant? And based on that, we decide on treatments. And I don't have time to get into the details of treatments today, but we wanted to know that if you're not going to transplant, typically we give people just a triplet combination for a long period of time. If patients are transplants, we give them those triplets, then do the transplant, and then typically put them on what we call maintenance therapy to maintain that transplant. In my last couple of minutes, let me ask three questions for transplant eligible and ineligible that I think are really relevant to our discussion today. Is transplant still necessary? With all these new treatments that Dr. Badros is going to share with us in about 4 minutes, is transplant still necessary? What is the best triplet combination that I should be using? And should we be going actually to quadruplets? Well, let me try and answer them really quickly. We still see transplant helping. And right now, transplant still has a role. When we think of what triplet combination we're going to use, more often than not, we use what's called VRD or KRD with Velcade Revlimid Dexamethasone or Kyprolis Revlimid Dexamethasone. They're both very good combinations. And you need to talk to your doctor about which one matches you the best. And then thirdly, are we going to actually go from triplets to quadruplets? I think most of us in the myeloma community think that's going to happen, that we're going to add either daratumumab or another drug called isatuximab to these triplets. And that's something that by the time we would do this workshop, say next year, we may have a full answer to, but we are moving in that direction. So in transplant patients, we're likely moving to quadruplets. We still see a role of transplant. We're still not sure if we need to give treatment right after a transplant, but we are also wondering if we need to do more in maintenance therapy. And that's beyond the scope of today, but for those who are interested, I think we're going to see more on maintenance therapy soon. And then lastly, three questions for the transplant ineligible group. Are triplets better than doublets? How long should we be treated? And how can we make these combinations better? Well, first of all, I think we've shown unequivocally now, we just got some recent evidence presented at one of our meetings, that giving long-term treatment is better for patients. And so I think we're going to be using more of the VRD, Velcade Revlimid Dexamethasone, and DRD in particular, daratumumab Revlimid Dexamethasone, the combination I use the most in transplant ineligible patients. In general, as long as people are tolerating it, again, we don't look at patients and say, you'll take it and you'll like it. We try and give it to them in a strategic way, and we back off if people are having symptoms. But the longer we stay on it, the longer we stay in remission. And then lastly, it really is important that we're using drugs that help patients control their myeloma, but we don't want just quantity, we want quality. We want to improve patients' quality of life. And so now we're using a little less transplant in some of these patients who historically we really push transplant in. We're typically using three drugs instead of two, as I've mentioned. I tend to favor using DRD in most patients, but I still use VRD in high-risk patients. And I do think we may even be looking at quadruplets before too long in that transplant ineligible population. So to wrap it up here, look at this list. I mean, it's almost ridiculous. In red, what have we been doing for a long time? In green, what Dr. Badros is going to share with us that we've just added. And in purple, maybe the future of what we do in multiple myeloma.